Everyone, are you ready to talk availability zones? Now, these are a very good mechanism for providing availability, but I wanted to make it really clear that availability zones are not a DR mechanism. Okay, with that in mind, let's cover the requirements, prerequisites, and then we'll actually deploy an availability zone. So picture this. We've built our management domain. We've got four hosts. These hosts are specifically built for management tools in the management domain. Now, remember we've spoken about every time you build a workload domain, all the management tools are put in the management domain. So logically thinking, you'd want availability for these tools. Now, what does that mean? It means we need to add additional resources to provide a second availability zone. Note, we're talking about availability here and not disaster recovery. Disaster recovery is all about backups and retention and all that sort of stuff. This is all about availability. We add an additional four nodes, which should be of equal size and resources compared to the initial four hosts. Now we've got an additional four nodes, which means we've got extra capacity and place for failover. But just adding these four hosts into SDDC and commissioning the hosts doesn't achieve what we want. It ends up building a second vSphere cluster. Typically in an outage scenario, you want automated failover, which means you need vSphere HA. vSphere HA won't work across two vSphere clusters, so we need to turn this into a single logical availability zone. What that looks like is a single vSphere cluster in vCenter. With this single AZ across two localities, which can be a single another rack or another data center, as long as it meets the RTT requirements of vCen, means you've also got to stretch your networks, and we'll go through what that means, which networks, all that sort of stuff in the coming slides. But it also means you need a third site for a vCenter witness appliance. You do not want to run the witness appliance in one of these two sites because it doesn't really serve its purpose. It needs to be able to see both sites from a third location to see which one's actually down and can actually be connected to then promote that site to be the primary. And then all those workloads will seamlessly fail over to the remaining availability zone. Now, if we were to take this a little one step further, as I said already, we have all the management tools for any subsequent workload domain sitting in the management domain. Now, you do need to stretch the management domain before stretching any VR workload domain. And that's just the supported path for availability zones for workload domains. And if you were to think about it logically, it makes sense. You want the management tools for the workload domain to also be available when the workload domain is also available. In the coming slides, we'll go through the network requirements and the prerequisites, and we'll go straight into the demo. Networking requirements are arguably the most critical aspect of an availability zone design and deployment. Picture the two AZ approach that we have been talking about. Starting from the top down, the first network we're going to discuss is the management network, arguably one of the most important networks. This port group and VLAN needs to be made available across both availability zones. Now picture this, you want seamless failover from one site to the other. All those management appliances need to sit on this network and also need to be made available on the other side. You don't want to re-IP, as I've said before. So what this looks like is we've got every VMK0, which is the management interface of each hypervisor on this management port group, as well as the SDDC manager, NSX and vCenter of every workload domain, including the management domain that sits here. So if site one goes down, these need to fail over to site two, and we don't want to re-IP to make this as seamless as possible. So that's why this network needs to be stretched. Next, we've got the vSAN network. The vSAN network doesn't need to be stretched anymore. It used to be traditionally, but not any longer. And I'm a bigger fan of avoiding stretching networks where not required. Similar with the vMotion network can be routed now as well. Then we've got the host TEPs. Host TEP connectivity is a mandatory requirement for overlay traffic to be able to, for tunnels to form across availability zones. And what I mean by that is you can have separate subnets for each availability zone for the host TEPs. They just need to be able to communicate and have the required ports open. Next, we've got the edge TEPs. The edge TEPs have to be stretched. Why? Because the edges are a virtual appliance. This TEP interface, well, we're talking about a virtual appliance here, we're not talking about bare metal. The edge TEPs reside on the VM, and TEP-to-TEP connectivity between edges as well as host-to-edge TEPs is required for overlay tunnels to form and that north-south and east-west routing all to work. When the edge fails over, if it fails over and that same TEP subnet or gateway is not available in the second availability zone, that tunnel will never form to those edges and you've got broken data path connectivity or data plane connectivity. Then we've got the two edge uplinks, both need to be stretched as well. Because think about this, across these uplinks, we've got the TEP or the Geneva tunnels forming, we've got data path forwarding, we've also got BGP peering. If these uplinks are not stretched, the edges will move across, but the same subnet is not available. So BGP won't automatically peer the same addresses and routing prefixes or wrap prefixes will not be advertised automatically. There are ways around this, but the preferred approach is to stretch these two networks to make this transition as seamless as possible. The main requirements of the witness appliance are: one, it needs to be in a different location to the two availability zones. Two, the management interface, if you choose to do it this way, needs routed connectivity back to the vSAN VM kernel interfaces at both availability zones. Three, it doesn't need jumbo frames. It just needs, it supports mixed matched MTU. It doesn't need to be 9K all the way through, as it is just the witness appliance. The stretched AZ approach has a synchronous replication, which means data is constantly replicating backwards and forwards. We did also touch on earlier about creating individual clusters within a workload domain and not stretching anything, and having network availability using NSX. Remember, each workload domain can use the same NSX, and then that way leverage the same network segments that you've got created. This is more for the workload domain rather than the management domain. But if you do go with that approach where you've got standalone clusters, you do need to work out a way to have data replicated to the other stretch or the other cluster, if that is what you want. If you're defining workload in A and B type scenarios where you've got two web servers and load balanced, you don't need to worry about that. But it is just another way to have failover availability across two standalone clusters. First things first, we need to create the network pool for the vSAN and vMotion networks in AZ2. Quite simple to do. I've shown you how to do this in the previous video, so I'm going to go ahead and do that and I'll come back. All right, that network pool is created. So quickly, vSAN and vMotion, two different VLANs separate to what was for AZ1, and address pools or IP ranges carved out. Next, we need to commission the hosts. Commission host, just go to host, commission hosts, read through the list, make sure you're good with everything, select all and proceed. This time we'll use the import function. I've just downloaded the JSON and populated it myself, and that's all you really need to do. So I'm gonna browse to that file now, open it up and hit upload. It quickly passes the JSON, make sure it's all valid, and then imports all the host. Now you need to validate the fingerprint. To do so, select that box there, and it automatically checks all of them, and then you click validate. Once that is good, we can proceed. All those fingerprints validated successfully. Now we just hit next and commission. That'll start the commissioning process. That task is finished. All those hosts have been commissioned and we can see them here. Next step is to deploy the vSAN witness appliance before we can stretch. Log into Customer Connect, you're onto the vSAN version that you need, and then find the witness appliance under drivers and tools. That download has complete, so we'll now go through and deploy the OVA. Select the local file that was just downloaded. Next, give it a name, select the compute cluster, review the details, accept the license agreement. I'm just gonna deploy a tiny one in my case, but size it accordingly to your environment. Pick the data store. The network configurations here are quite important. The first one is obviously the management network. So I will select the appropriate management network. And the secondary interface here is supposed to be the vSAN witness traffic. But in my case, I don't want to stretch that vSAN witness traffic. I will enable the first interface to carry the vSAN witness traffic, and I'll show you how to do that. So I'll click next here. I'll fill out all this and we'll come back. Password, pretty straightforward. This one's important, vSAN traffic. So you've got two options. So you've got the secondary network or the manager network. So which one do you want to configure to carry the vSAN witness traffic? As I mentioned, I'm going to use management. So I've selected that, filled out all the management network details. I've left the secondary network blank. So I'll hit next now, hit finish, and that'll start deploying. Notice it's powered off. I need to power it on and we'll let that complete. All right, so that witness appliance is deployed, it's powered on. I'll just do a quick connectivity check. We can see the interface itself is up. Let's also test this from one of the hosts and the vSAN VMK, because that is the more important part. Let's have a look at what the vSAN VMK is. Jump into here. All right, vSAN is VMK2. So we're on host one now. I'm going to run that VMK ping from the vSAN interface and enter there. We can see that's good with connectivity. Now, you may be asking the question about MTU. Yes, jumbo frames are required on the data network of vSAN, but the witness appliance supports mixed MTU, so you don't need jumbo frames configured on the vSAN witness appliance port groups. Perfect. So now that's done, we can move on to the next part. Okay, we're ready to start stretching the cluster. The first thing we need to do is grab the host IDs from the ones that we just commissioned, as well as the cluster ID for the cluster that we're going to be stretching. Go into host, click on the host, pick it up, or URLs from over here. Same thing can happen for the clusters. Jump into management domain, hit the domain clusters, click on the cluster, and grab the cluster ID. You want to copy and paste them into a document so then we can populate the JSON, which we're going to do next. This is the JSON. that we need to populate. I've obviously blanked out the license keys, but as you can see, I've validated this JSON and it was successful. When you do validate this, it needs to be a post and you need to send it to /validations. As always, we always want to validate the JSON spec before posting or patching it. Once you've validated it and you're good, we need to come back in here, we'll remove validations. We also need to remove this line here, otherwise the post or the patch request will fail. And just remove another bracket. You hit send on that as a patch request. This will start the process of stretching. Now I'm gonna issue this command here, so let me do that and then we'll follow along as the process continues. Okay, so I hit send on that request. We should be able to see a task in here now. All right, so that's still coming along. As that was going through the process, it failed on something with the vSAN witness appliance, and I did miss a critical step. I forgot to register the vSAN witness appliance with the vCenter and where the cluster resides. So let's do that now. Go back into vCenter, we'll go to add a host. I'm going to use the DNS entry, click next, put in the root password, username and password, verify the certificate, click through, apply a license, select lockdown mode. I'm gonna hit disabled on that one. Location of where you want it to reside, I'm just gonna put it in the data center and hit finish. We'll allow that process to complete. It will connect itself and come good. Okay, so that has completed. Let's go back and retry that task. There you go, it went past that witness appliance task, which means the config is now valid and it will move on. So it's now doing the rest of the connectivity checks. We can see the task has been successful. If we click on it, we can see all the subtasks. There are a whole heap of tasks that go on in the background. Just imagine how much time that would have taken if you did it yourself. Next, I'll show you vCenter. We can see all 8 hosts are in a single logical cluster. We'll have, you can see there's also the VM host rules. All the VMs are set to run on the primary AZ host group, which is the first 4 hosts. If you want to have a look at the host groups, we can just click at everything that's been created here. So the management cluster VMs, then we've got the secondary AZ host group and the primary AZ host group. All the VMs are primarily going to be attached to the primary AZ host group using DRS rules. And in the event of a failure, they'll move over. Now, I'm sure you actually want to see a failover in action. To do so, I'm going to trigger an outage and we'll see what happens. So I have gone ahead and killed the links to those first four hosts. Probably can't notice it yet in this screen. If you notice this, I'm trying to refresh. vCenter's just down, so we know that it's just dead. So if I look at the hosts now, we can start to see VMs coming up on the other side. Notice host 5, region 1, host 6 has also got a VM getting spun up in it, edge 2, and then we've got VC being spun up on host 7, edge 1 and STDC manager on host 8. Let's give it a bit more time for vCenter to get spun up and I can give you the end result. There you have it. You can see 4 hosts in a not responding state. Those are the first 4 hosts in primary AZ that are shut down. The last 4 are still up. Everything has come back and it's alive. You can see I'm still on the same vCenter. You will probably notice that there's one VM still disconnected. That'll eventually come good. It's just taking a bit more time in my lab environment. How cool is that? I mean, you've got an outage, you've got a site failure, and you've got automatic recoverability. Hopefully by now you understand how to get from start to finish with an availability zone and all the requirements. Now, in order to get to this stage, you do need a management domain, and also you need to understand the STDC manager and some of the API. Now, I'll catch you in the next video where we'll discuss regions, but hopefully you've got a firm grasp on availability zones. Thanks for watching.